So during this last course, I will give you one or two more impossible constructions in the spirit of what we did yesterday. So let me remind you that yesterday we proved that the number square cubic square root of cubic root, sorry, of 2 is not constructible. And the proof used little number theory based on the notion of chain of fields which contain the constructible numbers. So in the same spirit, I would like to show you something else, another construction which is impossible by ruler and compass. So this second construction is the following. The regular heptagon. So if I am correct, an heptagon is a polygon with 7 sides. So if you remember, we already proved that the triangle, the square, and the regular pentagon were constructible with ruler and compass. I claim that the hexagon is easy, because an hexagon can be constructed with points with very simple coordinates. Now I would like to see and I try to prove you that it is not possible to construct a regular heptagon with ruler and compass. So if you draw a picture, so you draw the circle, so one the first vertex of the heptagon is the point 1 here, 1, 0, and then you have to figure to draw 6 points, something like that. I don't know exactly where. Huh? And of course here, by being regular, all the angles here are going to be the same. So the angle alpha here is the angle 2 pi divided by 7. So proving that the this polygon is not constructible means that we have to prove that this side here, which is cosine of alpha, is not a constructible number. So we have to prove, we want to prove, that cosine of 2 pi over 7 is not constructible. Am I clear? So the general problem of proving or disproving the constructibility of a regular polygon is, can you prove that cosine of 2 pi divided over n for an integer n is constructible or not? That's the general thing. So this is what I will do, a single example of this kind of problem now with n equals 7. So in order to do so, I want to use the tools we have developed yesterday, which use the notion of chain of fields for constructible numbers. So I am going to assume that this number cosine of 2 pi over 7 is constructible, and then reach contradiction. So assume that the number cosine of 2 pi divided over 7 is constructible. And in order to reach a contradiction, we are going to use something we already did for the pentagon, which consists in considering the complex number omega, the complex number omega, which is the exponential of 2i pi over 7. Okay, so the cosine we are interested in is the real part of this complex number. So I am going to work with this complex number in order to be able to use some algebra here. So as you know, omega, the number omega, is the root of the polynomial of the polynomial x7 minus 1 equals 0, okay, which have this polynomial has 7 complex roots. It's a high degree 7, so I want to simplify a little bit this polynomial. So in order to do so, notice that this polynomial has an obvious root, which is x equal 1. So we can factor in this polynomial, we can factor out x minus 1. So what we have is x7 minus 1 is equal to x minus 1 multiplied by x6 plus x5 plus x4 plus x3 plus x2 plus x plus 1. Okay. So this is a long polynomial, but the degree is a bit lower. Now we notice that omega is not a root of x minus 1, of course. My number omega, it is this one, which means that omega is a root of this polynomial. So omega is a root of this polynomial. Okay, and you might remember that for the polygon, we transformed a little bit this long polynomial here to make it more symmetric. And actually, so we have, let me write here, omega 6 plus omega 5 plus omega 4 plus omega 3 plus omega 2 plus omega plus 1 equals 0. And the idea is to factor out omega 3, omega cube, in this polynomial. So, if we do so, we obtain omega 3 plus omega 2 plus omega plus 1 plus, and here, if I factor out omega 3, I have omega minus 1 plus omega minus 2 plus omega minus 3 equals 0. So, the effect of this little trick we just did here is to have a more symmetric situation here, which is always convenient. And now I am going to introduce a new number, x, which is omega plus omega minus 1. Okay, see, just definition. So this number omega plus omega minus 1, so it's the sum of omega and its conjugate, so it is equal to twice the real part of omega. So this number is nothing but twice cosine of 2 pi divided by 7. Am I correct? So if I want to prove that the cosine is not constructible, it is the same to prove that x itself is not constructible. Multiply by 2 doesn't change the fact that a number is constructible or not. Okay? So I want to transform this equality satisfied by omega and omega minus 1 here into an equality satisfied by x. And I will use elementary tricks. For example, here, you notice omega cube and omega minus 3 here, which means that I will consider omega plus omega minus 1 raised to the power 3. So this polynomial here can be expanded by the classical binomial formula, but of course I will get omega cube, omega minus 3, perfect, but here, if I write this, I have to remove 3 omega square times omega minus 1 minus, I have to remove also omega, 3 omega and times omega minus 2. Am I clear? This is equal, this expression here is equal to omega cube plus omega minus 3. Très bien. So let's don't change this for the moment. Now I will do the same game with omega square here and omega minus 2 here. So we have omega plus omega minus 1 square minus the double product, which is twice omega times omega minus 1. Okay? Correct so far? So what did I forgot? I forgot everything in the middle, which is plus omega minus 1 here, plus 1, and all this big sum is equal to 0. So now I'm going to arrange a little bit this long expression. So let's see what do we have here. So here we have omega plus omega minus 1, which is my number x. So we just have x cube. Here omega square minus omega times omega minus 1 is omega. And here is omega minus 1. So I have minus 3x. Is it correct? For the second line here, this one is x squared. And this one here is minus 2 omega times omega minus 1, that is minus 2. And finally, I have omega plus omega minus 1, which is x, plus 1. So plus x plus 1 equals 0. Am I correct? So if I organized a little more this polynomial, we have x satisfy the equation x cube plus x squared minus 3x plus x, which is minus 2x, and minus 2 plus 1, which is minus 1, equals 0. So x, which is twice the cosine I am interested in, is actually a solution of this polynomial equation of degree 3. Remember that we assumed from the beginning that cosine and x are contractible numbers. So I want to obtain a contradiction from that. So the information we have is the polynomial. So let me call p of x this polynomial of degree 3. This polynomial, by assumption, has at least one constructible root, p of x here. So by assumption, p of x has at least a constructible root. At least one. Maybe two, maybe three, I don't know. But at least one. Is it clear so far? So, from this sentence, I want to reach a contradiction. Okay, so among all these possible constructible roots, one of them has a minimal height, if you remember the notion of height we introduced yesterday. So among these constructible roots, one of them, called, say, gamma, has a minimal height. Okay? Remember that the height is the length of a tower of fields necessary to contain this number gamma. So I consider a constructible root of the polynomial p of x with minimum height. Right. So, first thing, Can this 8 be 0? Can this 8 be 0? What does it mean for a constructible number to have a 8 equals to 0? It means that this number is rational. So that is, can gamma be a rational number? And of course you guess that the answer is going to be no. But we have to prove it. So we have to prove that P of X cannot have any rational root. So suppose it has. So suppose that P of X has a rational root. M divided by N with M and N relatively prime, M in N in Z, sorry, so M being an integer, possibly negative, and the denominator n being a positive integer. So suppose that. So let me be as simple as possible. I will simply plug in m, plug m divided by n in this polynomial to check if it is possible to have zero, to obtain zero. And I will see. So what we obtain if we do so, we obtain m cube divided by n cube plus m squared divided by n squared minus 2m divided by n plus minus 0, 1, sorry, equals 0. And of course, I will multiply everything by n cube to have equality as simple as possible. So we obtain m cube plus m squared times n minus 2m times n squared minus n cube equals 0. So if the polynomial P of X has a rational root, this the ratio solution of P of X has to satisfy this. Right? So I claim that it is not possible. So how can we prove this? Well, if you consider the first terms, the three first terms of the polynomial, you can factor m out of the three first terms. So we would have that m divides n cube. Am I clear? Because we can factor out m from the three first terms of the polynomial. In the same spirit, I can factor out n from these three terms here. So we would have also that n divides this term, which is m cube. Okay? But remember that m and m, exactly, so we have not much possibility here. So the only possibility is that n equals 1. Okay? Because n is positive, and m here is plus or minus 1. So if the polynomial P of X has a rational root, this root is automatically plus 1 or minus 1. So m over n is equal to plus or minus 1. So let's check, is 1 a root of this polynomial? So if you consider 1, you have 1 plus 1 which is 2 minus 2, which is 0, and minus 1 is not 0. And if you consider minus 1, you have minus 1 plus minus 1, which vanish. Plus 2 minus 1 is not 0. But plus or minus 1 is not a root of P of X. Okay? So if P of X has a constructible root of 8, with some 8, this 8 cannot be 0. So the 8 of gamma, hence, the 8 of gamma is positive. Okay, it's not zero. Okay, so now we have a tower of fields, and the last element of this tower contains gamma. So we have the following situation. We have a tower of fields, as we said yesterday, and we have the situation Fn minus 1, which is one field of this tower, contained in F minus 1 of square root of R, n being greater than 1, and R belonging to Fn minus 1 with square root of R not belonging to Fn minus 1. So this last field, I call it Fn. This is the last field of the tower. And the number gamma belongs to the last field. And gamma belongs to Fn, but not to, Fn minus 1. Am I clear? So this is the effect of being... Remember, yesterday we proved that every constructible number is actually what I call a term. And this has a consequence that every constructible number, we can associate to this number a tower of field, such that the constructible number belongs to the last one, the last field of the tower, but not the previous one. And we added square root and square root and square root to build the tower. Okay, so we have this situation. So the constructible number gamma, so gamma can be written as b a plus b square root of r with a and b in fn minus 1. And moreover, b non-zero. B non-zero, otherwise if B was zero, it would mean that gamma belongs to Fn minus 1, which is not the case. Okay, so we have P of gamma. So gamma is the root of the polynomial P of X. So P of gamma, which is equal to P of A plus B square root of R, is equal to zero, vanishes. Okay. Now, if you remember what we did yesterday for square root of 2, we are going to do exactly the same trick here, which means I am going to expand P applied to A plus B square root of R. I will not write all the details, but I guess you will agree easily that actually P of A plus B square root of R can be written as the sum of two terms, A, capital A of AB, plus capital B of AB multiplied by square root of R, where so A of AB and capital B of AB belongs to Fn minus 1, and moreover, and A of AB is an even function, is an even function of B and B, capital B of AB, is an odd function of B. Because you collect all the positive power of B in one coefficient capital A and all the odd powers of B in the other coefficient capital B. So this is exactly what we did yesterday for square root of x squared minus 2. So I will not write the details of this on the blackboard because it is absolutely straightforward. I have nothing smart to add to this thing, so I let this as a very little exercise. Okay, but now remember that gamma is a root of the polynomial. Remember that P of gamma equals zero, which implies that the two numbers A of AB equals zero and B of AB equals zero. These two numbers have to be zero because square root of R is supposed not to belong to Fn minus 1, which means that the two coefficients vanish. Okay, so what's happening if I replace B by minus B? So A of A minus B, which is equal to A of AB because A is an even function of B, has to be zero as well. And in the same idea, B of A minus B, which is equal to minus B of AB because capital B is an odd function of little b, vanishes as well. So this elementary computation shows you that if A plus B square root of R is a root of P of X, then what we could call the conjugate A minus B square root of R is also a root of P of X. Okay, so far? So we are almost done here. We are almost done. So we start, remember that the polynomial P of X is of degree 3, which means that this polynomial must have at most 3 complex roots. Okay, but what we proved here is that this polynomial has at least 2 real roots, A plus B square root of R and A minus B square root of R. So P of X has at least 2 real roots, which are A plus B square root of R and A minus B square root of R. Am I clear? So my question is, what is the third root of the polynomial of P of X? What is root, what is the third root of P of X? Of course, it has to be a real number. It cannot be complex, because otherwise we would have 4 roots with the conjugate, right? So it has to be real. So I guess you know the trick. Once you know 2 roots of a cubic polynomial of degree 3, it's very easy to find the last one, because the sum of all the roots is exactly the opposite of this coefficient here. When you have a polynomial of degree 3, a monic polynomial of degree 3, the sum of the three roots, complex roots a priori, is the opposite of the coefficient of x squared. So the sum of the roots of the three roots is equal to the opposite of the coefficient of x squared in P of x. So let me give a name to this famous third root, a letter not used before. Let me call it delta. So the third root here, delta. So I call delta the third root of P of x. So what do we have? The sum of the three roots is equal to the opposite of this coefficient, which is minus 1. So we have a plus b square root of r plus a minus b square root of r plus the delta I am looking for, the third root, equals to minus 1. So now we know delta. So what is delta? Delta is minus 1 minus 2a, if I'm correct, thanks to this last equality. Okay, is it correct?
Yeah.
The sign is good? Yep. Okay, but notice that A belongs to Fn minus 1. So the third root, the mysterious third root, actually belongs to Fn minus 1. Right? So what did we prove here? We proved actually that the polynomial P of x has a constructible root of 8 at most n minus 1. So P of x has a constructible root delta of 8 at most bounded by n minus 1. Am I clear? So I claim there is a contradiction here. This is impossible. So can you see why it is impossible? So let me underline one word written on the board. The root gamma we consider from the beginning is supposed to be the constructible root of minimum 8, which means that no constructible root of this polynomial can have 8 strictly smaller than n. So contradiction. So this contradicts, I don't know how to say it in English, but okay, contradicts the hypothesis of minimal 8 for gamma. Okay? End of the proof. We have a contradiction here. So the regular heptagon is not constructible. So of course now we have a big question. Given n, given n question. Given n greater than 7 is the regular polygon with n sides constructible. Which means that another way to say the same thing is cosine of 2 pi divided by n constructible. Okay. So we can try to do things. I mean, for if n is not too big, we can consider, for example, I mean, if n equals 8, it's obvious. Because you can divide and bisect the angle, it's obvious. N equals 8, it's obviously true. I mean, for n equals 9, it's less obvious, and the answer will be no. And so on and so on. And Gauss proved when he was a kid, he was pretty good in math, that cosine of 2 pi divided by 17 is constructible. By algebraic considerations that I will not tell now. But he didn't give the construction. He say, okay, it is constructible. He didn't give the construction, and another guy later gave the geometric construction. So he took his compass, his ruler, and he gave the picture. So now, I mean, it would be nice to have a general result given n is cosine of 2p divided by n constructible or not. And later, Gauss gives the total answer to that. So there is a beautiful theorem. I will going to state it without proof because it would be long and hard. Which characterize the constructible regular polynomial. So theorem, that before the theorem I need a little definition. I don't know if you know it or not, so I'm going to give it anyway. Definition, it's possible that some of you already have already seen this definition. A prime Fermat number already seen that maybe you know? Yeah you have seen that already you know that no so a prime Fermat number is a prime number number of the form two to the n plus 1 with n an integer. So if such a number is a prime number, we will call it a prime Fermat number. The reason is that Fermat did some work about some research on these numbers, and Fermat believed that all the numbers of this shape, of this form, were prime. So let's add a remark here. Fermat believed, so around 1650, something like that, huh? Fermat believed that every number two to the n. So let me simplify the notation. People call them f sub n equal two to the two to the n plus 1 is prime. Okay. Let's play a little bit with it. So let's try to compute the small Fermat numbers, and we will see. So if n equals 0, so f0 equals 2 to the 2 to the 0, which is 2, plus 1 is 3. Okay, this one is prime. So now f1 is 2 to the 2 to the 1, that is 2 to the 2, plus 1 equals 5. Perfect prime. Okay, f2. Now we are enthusiastic, I guess. So f2 is 2 to the 2 to the 2, that is 2 to the 4 plus 1, which is 16 plus 1, 17. Am I correct? Notice that this 17 here is actually equal to this 17 here. It is not totally by chance. So we can go further. And actually, Fermat was wrong. I won't do the total computation on the board because it's not really interesting to do so. But actually, Euler proved that which one, f with the power with an n equals 5, is. So Fermat was in 1640. So he wrote a paper about some letters about this, but Euler proved that so F5, which is 2 to the 2 to the 5 plus 1, equals to 641 multiplied by 6700417. So it's not prime. It was pretty good in computation, Euler. So imagine that they didn't have any computers, nothing, by hand. So this one is not prime. Of course, we can check this in 1 second now with our computers. The fact is, what progress have been made now in the understanding of prime Fermat numbers, but actually, it's bad. I read recently that what is known that if n is bigger than 5 and smaller than, say, 30 something, Fn is not prime. This is known. I don't know how people manage to factor, a huge computation, big lab computers, and so they could do that. But if n is bigger, is big, so 4 bigger n, it is not known. They might be prime or not. Okay, which means that the only known prime numbers are f0, f1, f2, f3, f4, and that's it for the moment. So if one of you proves something for big N, you are going to be rich. That's the purpose of math. I mean, we want to make money, of course. So why did I speak about prime Fermat numbers? Because the answer of Gauss on this problem of constructible regular polygon involved the notion of prime Fermat numbers. So now it's time to state Gauss' theorem on the topic. So theorem. cosine of 2 pi divided by n is a constructible number, if and only if, so it is a characterization of contractible regular polygons of with n side, if and only if n equals to a power of 2 to k, to the k, multiplied by a product p1 times pl, where so k is an integer, possibly zero, and p1, so on pl, are prime Fermat numbers. Okay, that's it. So if the number of side of the regular polygon is a power of 2 multiplied by a product of prime Fermat numbers, we can guarantee that the polygon is constructible. For example, we know already a few of them. So we trust this result. I mean, it's proved by Gauss. I mean, it has to be true. So what do we know? For example, if n equals 5, 5 is a prime Fermat number, right? So if n equals 5, we know it is contractible. It works. 7 is not in this list, because after 5, it is 17. So 7 is not such a number. So the polygon with 7 sides is not contractible. This is what we prove by hand, right? And the famous 17 here is constructible. So the polygon with 17 sides, the regular polygon with 17 sides, is constructible according to this general result. Okay, so last exercise before going to another topic. Exercise from music theory. Which is connected to the problem of constructible numbers. Are you good in music theory? Some of you, you can read the notes and so on. No, you cannot. You sing and you don't sing. Come on. Do you know a little music? Do you play an instrument or something?
Violin.
Oh yeah, what? That's good. You play music?
No.
Which?
No.
Sorry?
No. Is that a kind of special instrument for
Turkey? It's a flute or something?
Yeah, it's a kind of flute, but it's not exactly like.
Ah, okay. Kind of flute? Turkish? It's Turkey. Ah, good. Do you play music? No? Okay, sorry. We'll see. So in the Western music theory, we have a notion of scale for notes. A scale, in French, it's the word gamme. I guess that Turkey is between Western and Eastern. I heard something that would not, in my ear, heard something which would not fit this totally Western music theory recently. So in Western music theory, notes are organized. So musical notes, of course, are organized in scales. So let me give an example of what we call a scale. We have the first note, which is a C. So I use here the international notation, English notation for music theory, C. And we, from the C, which is low, we want to go to the C which is high. It's called an octave, right? Octave. You agree? So low C and C. Can you sing it? No, you can't? Okay, he's shy today. So, what is the physical definition of the difference between a C, a low C, and a high C? So the low C has some frequency, of course. So some frequency, I don't know by heart, which is in hertz. So frequency, a number A, belong positive. Okay, so number of vibration by second. So this defines a note. Okay, the difference between the low C and the high C is that the frequency of the high C is twice the frequency of the low C. So by definition, high C has frequency twice A. Easy. So, defining a scale means defining the notes between the low C and the high C. In Western music theory, we have exactly 12 notes. Let me write them. C, C sharp, D, D sharp, E, and no E sharp, I guess.
Yes,
I guess. Oh, you forgot that. F, F sharp, J, G, G sharp, A, A sharp, and B, and no B sharp. So 12 notes. So this is the classical structure of music theory. The interval between two notes here is classically called an half tone. So an interval between two notes, two successive notes, in the Western scale is called a half tone. Is called a half tone. Okay. So once again, in nowadays Western music theory, the half tone is fixed, that is, the musical interval between every two successive notes in the scale has to be the same. So the question is, how can we compute the half tone? So what do I mean by that? I need a number B, so that is a number B such that what? When I take the frequency of C, of the low C, I multiply by this number, I obtain the frequency of C sharp. Then I multiply by the same number, I obtain the frequency of D. I multiply again by the same number, B, I multiply the frequency of D sharp, and so on, and so on. At the end, I obtain the frequency of high C, which is twice the frequency of low C. So what we do want, we want that B raised to power 12 multiplied by A is equal to twice A, to 2A. So we want a number, this is the half tone, satisfying this equation. So actually, solution of the equation B to the 12 equals 2. So the solution of this defines the half tone in Western music theory. So a classical question for quite a long time was, because people wanted to tune properly the instruments, so to compute exactly, as far as possible, this number. So the question is B a constructible number is B a constructible number. Okay, now this is a pure mathematical question. We can forget about music. So B equals, if I am correct, B equals 2 raised to the power 2 over 12. 1 over 12. Okay, question, is it constructible? And the answer is no. If B was constructible, if B was constructible, it would imply that B raised to the power 4 would be constructible. But what is this number, B raised to the power 4? Exactly, yes, cubic root of 2. And this number would be constructible. And we know since yesterday that it is not the case. And this is false. So in order to compute the half tone, we have to consider method, approximation method, but we cannot expect a finite and precise construction with rule and compass. That's life. Okay, it's a good time to a little break. Okay, so last section of this course. We proved already a few the non-constructibility of a few numbers, and the last one, the last problem is huge, much more difficult than all the previous ones. So the last one is classically called the quadrature of the circle. This expression is well known, at least in French. We use it frequently in Norman language, outside of math, to say that a problem is impossible. But usually people don't know where this expression comes from. So it has a long history, and I will state it in modern language. Problem is pi a constructible number? This is one way of stating this problem. Of course, people in ancient geometry, the ancient Greeks, were interested in geometric problem, wanting to know if we can compute the length of a circle by means of ruler and compass. It could be possible with the use of a compass, apparently. So the origin of this question is something like minus 30 before Christ. And nobody could answer for centuries and centuries. And the first answer has been given by a German mathematician called Hermit in 1873. So answer in 1873 by Hermit. So you see that sometimes solving a mathematical problem can be long. I mean, for example, you probably heard of the conjecture of Fermat, which is very famous. But between Fermat and now, what, 3 centuries at most? So this one, you can imagine. So the answer, what is the answer? The answer is no. Answer, no. So pi is not a constructible number. And what is the reason? I mean, the reason can be said very easily, I mean, very fast. The reason is the following. You might remember that a constructible number, any constructible number, is algebraic. That is a root of a polynomial with rational coefficients. Okay, and we gave a short proof of this yesterday. What did Hermite? He proved that simply pi is not algebraic. So Hermite proved that pi is not algebraic. I don't know if you know the terminology. A number which is not algebraic is classically called a transcendental number, right? So P is a transcendental number. Okay, it's a fact, that's it. So what can we say here in the context, in the framework of this course? I have considered, when I was preparing this course, to give a proof of that. But I could not find any proof, how can we say, appealing. So all the proof is a bit long, a bit technical, but not extremely deep. And at the end of the proof, you would have learned only how to prove that P is transcendental. I mean, you wouldn't have learned a lot of mathematics, actually. So I decided not to prove this for you. The proof can be found on the web, for example. I have nothing smarter to show you about this. So I decided to show you something else, which is, in my mind, beautiful. I will focus simply on the fact that pi is an irrational number, which is already something. It's not the statement here, but it's already something. So pi is irrational. So we will simply prove that pi is irrational. Of course, I am perfectly conscious that this is much weaker, but it's already something. So what I do prefer to do so, to prove this, is that I'm going to show you a proof of the irrationality of pi, which actually works for many numbers, different from pi. And probably you have not seen that. So you have to know that the proof of irrationality of pi, it has been done several times. And the first proof was extremely complicated, long use of continuous fractions, and so on and so on. And in 1946, a number series called Niven gave one-page proof of the irrationality of pi. Compared to the, I don't know how many pages the previous proof contained, it was extremely good news for the mathematical community. Well, to be honest, the proof has one page because it doesn't give a lot of details. So I will state a lemma, and I'm not sure to have time enough to prove it, but at least I will state a lemma, which is a simple lemma from analysis, I mean undergraduate analysis. And we are going to admit this lemma and to see the consequences of the lemma. I think it's better. So let me state the lemma first. So this lemma is the basic tool used by Niven in this proof. So consider a rational number alpha equals A over beta positive. Okay, consider such a number. And then, for every n integer, we define fn of x as the following function, x to the n, wait a second, a minus bx to the n, divided by factorial n. Okay, so this function is a polynomial. It's a polynomial of degree 2n, right? This function has vanishes at zero, and zero is a root of multiplicity n, and this polynomial vanishes at alpha, also with multiplicity n. So, and moreover, you divide by a number which is bigger and bigger when n increases. That's the idea. So consider a continuous function h, such that which admits a sequence of primitives, so h0 equals h, h1 prime equals h, also h0, h2 primes equals h1, and you take successive primitive. Am I clear? Infinitely many, such that for every j positive, hj at zero belongs to n, and hj at alpha, the point, the rational alpha I have from the beginning, also belongs to n. Okay, a bit mysterious for the moment. Huh? I guess it's enough for the conditions. Oh, yes, I forgot something. Moreover, H assume that the sign of H is constant on the interval 0 alpha. So these are for the hypothesis. Okay, so we have the polynomials fn and this sequence of primitive of the function f. So put in equals to the integral from 0 to alpha of fn of x multiplied by h of x dx. So it's an integral of a continuous function because this one is a polynomial. H is supposed to be continuous, so no problem in the integration. The idea is to understand the behavior of this sequence of integral. You might remember that at the very beginning of this course, I told you that we were going to investigate some algebra and at some point some analysis. Analysis is now. Now we can state the lemma. Then, first, for every n in n, the integral in belongs to n minus 0. So this integral, I claim, is a non-zero integer. And second point, the limit of in when n goes to infinity equals 0. Well, this is the statement of the lemma. So this lemma is really easy, based on elementary calculus, little analysis, just to give you a little idea, how can we estimate this value, the value of this integral, well, you know that you can compute an integral by integrating by parts, right? So we are going to compute in, you are going to compute the successive derivative of the polynomial, and then the successive primitive of h. So you integrate by part and again and again and again. This is why we need the sequence of primitives. Okay, so let's admit this. Why an intuitive idea, why the integral goes to zero? Because we divide by factorial n, which means that fn goes fastly to zero. Of course, this has to be made precise, but the rough ideas are here. So assume the lemma. Okay, trust me for a second. There is something weird here. The consequence of the lemma is that you have a sequence of non-zero integers which converges to zero. I have never seen that in my whole life, and I'm pretty old. So this is actually impossible. Okay, so this situation is impossible, which means that the hypothesis of the lemma can never be satisfied. So the hypothesis of the lemma can never be satisfied. Okay. So what I'm going to prove now, I'm going to the irrationality of P, and I am going to prove that if pi is a rational number, then we can produce the hypothesis of the lemma, and we will have a contradiction. So assume now that the proof of irrationality of P. So pi is irrational. Suppose pi rational. Pi is rational. Am I clear? So if pi is rational, I have to produce a rational number alpha, a function h, which satisfies all these hypotheses. Okay? So let me give you the number alpha and the function h. Alpha is going to be equal to p divided by 2, which is rational now, because p is rational. So this one is a rational number. So it's correct, because I want a rational alpha. Okay? So alpha here is p divided by 2, and the function h of x is sine of x. Wow. Do we satisfy the hypothesis of the lemma? Let's check. H has to be continuous. It is. Sine is continuous. So H is continuous. Okay? The sine of the function H has to be constant on the interval 0, alpha. So what is the interval 0, alpha here? It is the interval 0, pi divided by 2. And you know that the graph of sine is this. So sine of h is constant, positive. Positive, of course, it can vanish at the extremity, at the end point of the interval. Okay? Finally, we have to produce this sequence of primitives of h, so of sine here. So what are the primitives? Well, we know.
Sine pi is zero.
Oh, you're right. Yes, it's a mistake, you're right. So it should be pi, so I should stop here. Right. Excuse me, good remark. So my picture is not correct. Thank you. So here we stop at pi, at here. That's good? So H is positive. So now we can produce the sequence of primitives of sine. So we have obviously, so H0 equals sine. The derivative of x is called sine of x. H1 of x is cosine of minus cosine maybe of x. I always do this mistake. So this is a primitive of sine. H2 of x is, I guess, minus sine of x, and so on. Okay? And we have to check that the values of all these primitives at the endpoint of the interval are integers. And it is the case. Sine and cosine takes integer value at 0 and pi over 2. So for every j, h of 0 and h of pi over j of pi over 2 are, well, plus or minus 1, plus or 0, this kind of value, right? Am I correct? So we satisfy all the hypotheses of the lemma. So contradiction. Contradiction. Because the lemma leads to a contradiction, so it means that, hence, pi is irrational. Perfect. And I insist, the proof of the lemma is elementary math, undergraduate, huh? Nothing deep. Okay, so the interest of this proof is that with the same method, we can prove the irrationality of many other numbers. This is why I show you this proof. So now, second proof of irrationality, second result. I don't know if you knew it before, you are going to tell me. Other result. If for R, R belonging to Q minus 1, Q, sorry, positive minus 1, so a positive rational number different from 1, then logarithm of R is irrational. Is the statement clear? Of course, I have to remove 1 because log of 1 is 0. This is why. But for all other rational numbers, log of R is irrational. And the proof will be, again, an application of the lemma for a convenient rational number alpha and a convenient continuous function.
It's the nature of the lemma.
Can you repeat?
Nature of the
lemma. Can you repeat again, please?
That's LM, right?
That's...
No, no, log R, it's the nature of the
lemma. Oh, yeah, yes, yes, of course, yeah, yes, yes. How do you call that? Neperian logarithm, right? Yes, usually I write it. You prefer LN, maybe? I don't know your use here. Okay, so I mean, but you use the classical one. Yes. Très bien. So let me try to produce a number alpha, rational, and a continuous function H, which satisfy the hypothesis of the lemma. So alpha will be here, write R equals P over Q. So R is this number, this one is rational. We can suppose that this number is greater than 1. Otherwise, we can reverse the fraction and just put a sign, minus sign here. So we can assume this. It's not a great restriction. So log of R is positive. We assume log of R rational, and this is the contradiction we want to obtain based on that, and we put log of alpha equals log R, so it's a fraction. It's a fraction a divided by b. in Q. Okay? So if I assume log of R rational, I can take alpha equals log of R. This is the consequence of my assumption. Remember that I want a rational number for alpha. So I can do this if I assume log of R rational. I take log of R, right? So we're almost done. Now we have to define the function h, and the sequence of primitive. So what is it? It's pretty simple. H of x equals, h of x equals q exponential, q times exponential of x. Q being the denominator of the rational number r. Okay, so let's check that this is correct. So first of all, h is continuous. And moreover, it's pretty easy to compute the sequence of primitive of h, which are the same function. So hg of x is h of x for all j. Okay? So now we have to check that we satisfy the hypothesis of the lemma. So what do we have to prove? First, the sign of h has to be constant on the interval 0 alpha. Yes, it is. Exponential is positive. So the sign of h is constant. So this is clear. And now we have to check that for h of this is the function h, the value at 0 and the value at alpha is an integer. So let me check that. H of 0 is q times exponential to 0 of 0, which is q, which is an integer. Correct? So now h of alpha. So what is alpha? Alpha is log of r, log of r. So we see we have h of log of r. But remember that h is q exponential, q times exponential. So you have q times exponential of log of r, which is q times r. And r was p over q. So this is p, which is an integer. So the proof is done. We have the hypothesis of the lemma, so we have a contradiction. So this thing is very efficient. This is why I like it so much. So contradiction. So log of r is irrational. And now last one, last application. I don't know if you knew this result before. For the more or less a dual of the previous result, if R is a non-zero rational number, then the exponential of R is irrational. Did you know these results? Yes, you probably know that exponential of 1 is irrational. This is classically proved in classes, right? But it's much more general than that. And it does not cost much to prove it. Of course, I have assumed the lemma, but the lemma is pretty easy. Okay, so of course, I have to suppose that the rational number is not 0. Otherwise, we would have exponential of 0, which is 1. But for every other rational numbers, the result is irrational. So what is the proof? Once again, assume exponential of r rational. So here is a positive rational number. So we can compute its logarithm. to take the logarithm. So, log of exp of r, which is r, according to the previous case, the logarithm of a rational number should be irrational. So it would imply that r is irrational, is not rational, is irrational. I don't even need the lemma anymore for this. Is irrational according to the previous case, according to the previous result. According to the previous result. Okay? Which is a contradiction because R is rational by assumption. So contradiction. Okay? So you see with this lemma, and maybe there are other examples that I don't know, but you can cover quite a big family of real numbers which can be proved to be rational in the same way. So probably this guy here, Niven, didn't expect his result to be so good because he was focused on the irrationality of pi, but actually it turns out that his methods are very efficient. So I have enough time to give you, and then I will stop, I will not be too long because it's Sunday, it's my last course, but still a little idea, sorry, of the proof of the lemma, and I will focus, so I let you the first point as an exercise. And the hint is integration by part. So you do it again and again and check what you get, and that's it. I have nothing smart to add. So proof of the lemma. Proof of the lemma. So first point, exercise, integration, so repeated integration by parts. So we derivate fn and integrate h, and again and again and again. Okay. Just a little remark in this proof here. If you insist on derivate fn 1, 2, 3, 4 times, remember that fn is a polynomial, so of degree 2n. So if you derivate more than 2n times, you vanish. So this is why you can do the computation. Okay, this is a classical trick in integral calculus. So now, the proof of the fact that, the second point, the fact that in goes to zero when n increases. So let me write again in here to have it on the hands. So in equals the integral from zero to alpha, so which is a compact segment, closed interval, of the function fn of x multiplied by h of x, dx. Okay? So, in order to prove that this integral goes to zero when n goes to infinity, we have to bound the function we are going to integrate. So we want to bound this function. So can we do it? So we have to bound fn of x multiplied by h of x. And we want to bound it uniformly by a sequence of numbers which goes to zero when n goes to infinity. And then you can guarantee that the integral will go to zero. Okay? So how can we do so? Well, h of x is a continuous function on a closed interval. So it is bounded, you know that. So h of x is bounded by some number m on the interval zero alpha, right? Now, fn is more complicated because it depends on n, so I will not bound it by a single number. But what is fn? Let me write it again. Fn of x is equal to xn times, can you remind me the value of here? It is b minus
a minus bx.
Merci, thank you. A minus bx to the power n, yes, and divided by n factorial, right? Okay. So actually, we have to bound the numerator of this fraction, and it will be divided by factorial n. Okay. So how can we bound the numerator of this fraction? Well, it's easy because x belongs to the interval 0, alpha. Alpha, remember, is a over b. The numerator of the fraction is symmetric on the interval, so the graph has this shape. 0 here, alpha here, and something like that. This is fn. Fn is symmetric, vanishes at 0 and alpha. Okay? So we have to bound it on the half interval. That is here. Okay. But now, how can we bound this? Well, xn will be bounded by a constant raised by the power n to the power n, and it will be the same for a minus bx, which is symmetric here to x. So actually, the numerator and fn itself is bounded by some constant raised to the power n. So I am bounding here x times a minus bx raised to the n by some constant. So I raise to the n the constant, and I divide by this, n factorial. So what did we do actually? We bounded fn of x times h of x uniformly by the number m multiplied by c to the n, to the power n, divided by n factorial. Okay? So this is what I'll call a uniform bound. The bound here does not depend on x. It's a number which does not depend on x. So this is what is called uniform. Uniform bound. Am I clear? So if we can prove that this sequence of numbers goes to zero when n goes to infinity, classical theory of integration will tell you that in goes to zero. So the last exercise of this course, and we are going to study it briefly, is prove that so the number n will not play a role if I want to show that this sequence goes to zero. What is important is cn divided by n factorial goes to zero when n goes to zero. Have you seen that already, this kind of thing? So I am going to show you the solution of this exercise. And it will finish the proof of the lemma. So it's something you have to remember. It's a useful trick in analysis. You compare the powers
as n goes
to infinity. Sorry. Thank you. So you have to compare the powers, c to the n, and the factorial, n factorial. And I claim that n factorial is much bigger than c to the n. This is the idea. Well, it's intuitively, it sounds true, but how can we prove it? Have you seen that already? A long time ago, maybe? you remember the trick?
No.
So there is a little trick which is very beautiful here, which consists in considering the sequence, the series, sum of Cn divided by n factorial, c to the n divided by n factorial. Does it remind you something, this series? It should.
Euler's constant. Euler's constant.
Yeah. So it is?
C is 1.
Yes, for example, if C is 1, you recognize the factorial series, 1 over n factorial. But if C is not 1, this is exactly the formula for exponential of C. Right? So you should have said that at once, right? So, which means that this series here is a convergent series. And the sum of this convergent series is the exponential. So if this series is convergent, it implies that the general term of this series goes to zero. This is what we wanted to prove. So let me write this. Hence, the series of C to the n over factorial n is convergent. So the general term Cn divided by n factorial goes to zero. And this ends the proof. So this is the end of the proof of the lemma. So as you see, nothing deep in the proof. Nothing deep. Integration by part, thousands of times, and this elementary analysis. So this proves the lemma on all the cases. And this is the end of my course, and I thank you so much to be here during this week.